Welcome to the Startup Grind.
I'm Alexandra Zoneva. I'm chapter director of Startup Grind. Startup Grind is an international society of entrepreneurs, and the main idea of Startup Grind is to give opportunity to entrepreneurs share knowledge, experience, ideas. We are in more than 250 cities in Europe. We organize events, and each event has a speaker who is sharing his entrepreneurial story and the experience he has on the way to making a great company. Today, our guest is Christo Christoph from NetInfo. NetInfo is one of the biggest digital media company in Bulgaria. So he has a lot to share with us. The topic today is exponential growth. How NetInfo managed to reach exponential growth, to achieve exponential growth, and he will give us advices for our businesses. Hi.
Nice to meet you. What's your name again?
Alexandra.
Okay. I'm Christian.
Tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Starting from where? When I was born or after that?
You can start when you were three.
So, my first passion was playing tennis. I started playing tennis at the age of 5. I asked my mom how do I... I was watching Jim Kerr and Agassi, and I asked her how do I get to be as good as them. And she told me that they play tennis 8 hours a day. So I was at the age of 5 when I took a racket and I went on the cinema wall and started hitting the ball 8 hours a day. So this was the beginning how I started playing tennis. The first 5 years were awful, then I got a coach. But I grew up in Libya. I lived there for 5 years. I started studying in an American college, then got back to Bulgaria. Continued my education here. It was a disaster. And long story short, I graduated law. And during my law studies, I basically worked as a journalist. And coming back from the BBC in 2005, started basically the first news site in the portfolio. It was called Direct News. And that's how I started basically my first company. I didn't know it was a company back then. I had 10% of the company because I didn't own the brand. And I stepped on all the resources of Direct Radio. But 10% at the time, I didn't understand anything. So 10% looked like a very big deal. So I was greatly, greatly happy. And this is how I started.
And when did you become a CEO of NetInfo?
So after I started the news sites, basically I was 2005, so I was 21. I almost dropped out of law school. Actually, I dropped out, but then I had to finish it because of my very aggressive parents and huge scandals that I had with them, saying that without an education in Bulgaria, you're doomed. And by the way, I was accepted in a law school in La Sorbonne in France, but I didn't go there, I stayed here. I didn't know why at the time, but it seemed like a good idea. Probably it was a good idea, I don't know. So in 2000, and during the period that I started the digital news and basically we evolved, we created many more sets after that. I started several other companies. Most of them went bankrupt. Yesterday I was at the pitching competition, and I actually made the calculation that out of the 7 companies or 8 companies I've started, basically only 2 succeeded. The others went bankrupt. It's very good. I thought it was 10-2, but no. It was like great. But one of the other companies I started, which is it's called Most Finance. It's basically a bad debt management company. I started in 2009 when there was the credit crunch, and people didn't have access to finance, and all the banks started selling off their loans. So basically I created a company that started buying those loans and then collecting the money in a nice way.
Always.
But as we speak, we're doing an exit in this company to a huge UK fund. So this was between the process of starting the digital news business and buying a team. So in 2012, a friend of mine called me and he said, NetInfo is for sale. I said, send me the investment memo. He sent it to me, I saw it. I said, this is a crappy business, I don't want it. Who would pay such a huge amount for that business? And he said, I still remember it, I was driving with the car. What he told me is, imagine if you can achieve these results with the current management, what you can achieve. That's what he told me, and I think it was a good bait, so I bought it. And
where did you find the money?
I bought it without any money. we were the smallest bidder. I was competing against Nova, against Portal, against Investor, against the previous owner, who was actually the founder of NetInfo. He was right here, Lubin. Somehow I managed to sign the deal with Sonoma because we were super quick, and we had a vision which was compelling to the Sonoma guys, and they sort of believed us, and even though our price was lower than the highest bid, they sold it to us, and we were able to close the deal in 1 week. And after we closed it, basically I started looking for the money. So I had just put on my signature on a 8 million euro deal, and that's when I started looking for the money. And so after like basically the total, the entire deal was finalized in 13th of January 2014, so like 8 or 9 months after the Sonoma deal, I sold 70% to Nova, to FTG, who basically financed the entire deal. So this was the story of the acquisition. So, and that's how I became nice. And by the way, when we did the deal, I was so into the finance business that actually I told the guys that I'm going to continue running the finance business, and I'm going to keep the previous CEO of NetInfo. But along the way, basically we saw that this is not possible. And the stake was too high, and I had to step in, which was a pretty, it was a very tough moment, because I had to leave 1/3 of the team behind, and yeah.
And what is the mission of NetInfo now?
Well, the mission now, and probably always, and not only NetInfo, but my previous company as well, is to basically create value for its users, mainly in using the digital field. So whether it's creating quality news, whether it's creating a weather app for you to check the weather, whether it's managing your email or your contacts or your files, basically, or just pure entertainment, because entertainment also is something of value. It's always been basically to create value for our users. Yeah. Now we are in the transaction business, so it's even more, basically, we deliver even goods to those guys.
I just want to ask, do you hear everything in the Okay. Just to let you know that during the conversation you can ask questions, and it's important to have interaction with you tonight.
I've got a question. On what you just said there was, do you consider what you have as a service, or is it a platform?
Although I love the word platform, it's been overused, so I started hating it, because now everyone claim that they're a platform for something. So I started, it's like too broad for me. So what we deliver is absolutely a service, and it's across the board. So it's either a service for news, or a service for sports, or a service for weather, or for email, or for video entertainment, or for food delivery, or for groceries delivery, or for vouchers, or so. It's absolutely in the service field. The platform element, though, helped a lot, because this is part of the... I had prepared this answer for later, but actually, this is what helped us grow that fast. Because what we did was, we saw, it was, in 2013, Netinfo was a media company, digital media company. It created content, and it sold ads against that content. And basically, we used to do it in the old way. So it was, this is the site, put my ad on that site. So what we figured out pretty early on, actually it was, prior to the deal, even, and that's why we were able to buy it, is that we can use the same approach to deliver other type of services. So why create? Because that's a marketplace. It's like, on one side I have to create the content, on the other side I have to convince advertisers to sell their ads, to buy ads from me. So we said, the digital economy is super young, and people started consuming news online, but we saw it very clearly that they started shopping online, they started buying tickets for traveling online, they started buying vouchers and hotels. So we said, instead of going into the hyper-competitive space of digital media selling, where I have Google and Facebook on my back, I want to go into the space where I'm using basically the same, it's like you say, platform behind it, but I'm going in totally different economics, which is the huge economy of everything, because every service will have, not every, probably babysitting won't have until a certain moment, but a lot of services, retail, finance, finance banking, insurance, everything will be in some form digital. So we said, let's take the knowledge that we have from digital media, which is creating products, attracting users, building relationships with customers, analyzing, reporting, coding, machine learning now, and put it in other fields. So, barely. But that's good, because I really agree with Alex, is that it would be super fun for you to ask questions and interrupt me all the time, even if you're a company.
Speaking of which, just curious, how come Salomon
Went
with the lowest bid? What was the catch? What
No, so no one was selling the company.
Yes, but why did they choose you, since you had this smallest bit?
It wasn't the lowest. I'm not going to say who had the lowest. But tower wasn't the highest. It's several things. Number one is like when they discussed the acquisition and the deal with potential buyers. Basically, everyone was invited to sort of tell their story of what they're going to do with the company. So they were a super responsible seller. And they said, I want to sell the company to someone who is going to strategically evolve. And they admitted that they hadn't done so themselves. So they said, we really want for the next person to manage it. After the non-binding offer, after the NBO, the second thing was basically a meeting with them, with the guy who is managing the deals, with the CFO for the region, with the guy who was managing the asset, and basically explaining to them what you're going to do with the company. And there was a third factor, which was the, I would put it like, brand safety thing. So they wanted to sell to someone who had a good name. So these were like the three main components. And I think we had like very, very strong vision at the time, which in the beginning I was like totally against. I was like, nothing. And I said like, we had a 3 times smaller company and we were doing 50% of their EBIT. NetInfo at the time was doing 4.5 million revenue. It was like 2.2 million euros. So they wanted 4 times the revenue, which was like crazy. And it was declining with a double digit year on year. Which was like.
The topic today is exponential growth. So I would like to start with. Asking the question, what is exponential growth in practice?
Well, I don't want to get into definitions, but growing exponentially means either doubling your revenue every year, or like tripling your users every year, or like growing, basically means growing 20-30% month on month. When we did the deal, NetInfo was doing like 4.5 million level. In 18 and even now, basically we are going to be above 50 million in turnover. So it's like for 4 years we've grown 12x, and not all of that is revenue, but like. 65-75% is revenue, and so that's my definition. I don't give a
Well, now is the time to tell us how NetInfo achieved exponential growth. What's the story?
Well, in one sentence.
Three words.
Elevator pitches. Well, we know the Minister of Finance. He's a. It's not. We know the Minister of Finance. 5 words. No, so in 2013, we saw that there was an entirely different concept than the one that we believed in. So NetInfo was run top down, so basically, it was one person on top. Telling the rest of the team what to do. There were no one in the team had a bonus agreement, not even sales. I cannot imagine that. No one in the team had KPIs or OKRs after that. So basically, there was no clear path. For the last 2 years, so no one knew they were going to sell in 2011. So for the last 2 years, they had stopped all the cost, so they said costs have to be squeezed, they have to be going down, so there was no investment. Salaries were not being indexed, so it was like a total freeze across the board. And after I signed the deal with Sanoma, before CPC, which is Kazeka, because CPC had to approve the deal. It had to go into a process. They had to say yes, you can concentrate. It's not a marketing issue. But from the signing to the approval of Kazeka, there was like 6 or 7% of the people of IT of content writers basically left the company. So it was like a very very motivating time to work. And everyone in the company, because we were already a digital media company, they were a digital media company. And after we did the deal with Nova, Nova had a digital media division. So everyone in those three companies knew that everything will change. So you have a commercial director in one of the companies who knows that he's not or she is not going to be there, or thinks that he'll be there. So there was a lot of politics, it was a lot of intrigues. It was very funny. so basically we had to combine three companies into one. And we cannot even speak about innovation, there was no. Basically it was a survival. And a lot of the management of those companies knew that they're going to be fired. So NetInfo was not working with external partners. It was basically an enclosed company. They were like self-sufficient. They didn't have partnerships. They didn't have projects that they were working with smaller startups. They weren't open to other influence. And what else? What else? Basically that was the stage in 2013. So the first thing we needed to do was create one company. I still have all my files, which are NetInfo Daring Nova integration plan. So that's the first thing we needed to do. It was to create one team, and it was super hard because one of the companies is bigger, the other is like smaller, the third is a different stage. So it was different, three different cultures. And the first mistake that I did immediately after coming in was actually I thought that if I rebranded the company, if I put a new name on top of the company, it would ease the process. So if I call it Now Network or whatever, it would facilitate the process of people starting to basically think of this new company. And I spent like 6 months doing it. I launched a contest. We chose Now as a company name. We started creating and they are transparent to everyone else. Our adjustment, this is how we started, but our adjustment was that we made them so they called out from me, executive, operational, and team leaders, and then they reach the team level. So we don't break them down into separate players from the team level. So if you're from the team that basically does optimization management of campaigns, and you're like 3 or 4 people, you have one OKR goal. So we didn't go, because in our environment, people are very often changing one another, so you cannot really assign only one person with one OKR. So we set OKRs because innovation has to come from within the company. We couldn't, and in the beginning it was chaos. In the beginning it was everyone was doing something different. and in the beginning we continued the decline. Revenue, in terms of revenue, we very quickly rebounded, but in terms of products, we were declining, because everyone in the company was telling me, what should I do right now? what should I do? What's my goal? How should I achieve? And in the beginning, this is another mistake I made, I was like, okay, this is what you gotta do, let's figure out the features, let's figure out the product pipeline, how do we roll out. And then very clearly became clear that if I set the tone, basically those people are never going to learn to be responsible, to take charge themselves, to be aggressive, and to take risks. Because you're safe, because someone from top told you this is what you should do. So I backed a little bit, not a little bit, a big bit, and it was a sort of chaos because no one was telling them what to do. And they were like screaming, we don't have processes. You know, how should someone from this team work with me when I'm in that team and this guy didn't set? So it was messy in the beginning, I admit it. And probably it cannot work in all type of companies, in all type of businesses. But once it starts working, and there are like a million things which I don't want to go into detail, but how it can work. And for example, one of the ways it can work is every Monday and Tuesday we have product boards. So a product board is like a service board. So if you're the product manager of the sports site, for example, what you do is every Monday you have 1 hour. You have 1 hour, and it's 1 hour only, with full agenda, where you can invite different team members outside of your team. So you can invite marketing, you can invite sales, you can invite whatever, analytics, you can invite reporting, you can invite the data unit, you can invite IT, you can invite designer. So you invite those guys, and you have everyone from executive level sitting on the table. And you lead the board the way you want it. You say, I have this problem, and this problem. I want to fix it. Give me your solutions. So you give those problems prior to the meeting. You set an agenda. You prior to the meeting, before every meeting, the board members, so-called, the members of the product board, they receive the agenda with what are the problems that we're going to be solving. They might be huge problems, they might be smaller problems. And it acts like it's like an immersive experience for every single team member. Because what used to be before was we had those silos, and these guys from sales say, we don't know what product team is doing. Yeah. We don't know, they launched something, they didn't tell us, it was crappy, and so on and so forth. So what the product, and we took the product boards, we didn't invent them ourselves. We went to see Cessna, which is a huge Czech company. It's like Netinfo plus Google plus Raison, for those of you who know Raison. In Czech, they have like 170 million euro revenue. Czech is one of the four markets where Google isn't dominantly searched, by the way. It's because of Cessna. So we went to see those guys, and that's what they told us. They told us, from a certain point, when you have multiple services and multiple products, it's very difficult to keep units aligned. So there must be something acting as a glue, and top executives must be sitting there. Because if you're not there, if I'm not there every Monday, Tuesday, it's like, although I'm not an active participant, no, I basically I'm listening there, but it's I'm like facilitating and pushing the conversation, because it's very easy to fall into this like comfort zone where we are okay, we're doing good, but basically I'm acting as a provoking agent. Basically, I'm asking provocative questions.
That's a question I have, because I think it's an amazing concept. You know, because teams don't talk to each other.
No.
It's just a fact.
Yeah.
And it can all go pear-shaped very fast. And I was going to ask you, who was facilitating in the middle of it? Because sales, if they're fighting with tech, you know, tech and so forth, they can end up in the leadership fight.
Yeah, yeah. Just you being there is enough. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's not that I'm only... So there is a balance that I have to keep, because I talk a lot, sorry for that. So it's always like sometimes I see stuff which I cannot react to. You know, I must be able to shut down and to ask the question. I must be able to for example, I see two units arguing, and for me it's like I have an idea, it may not be the right solution, but I cannot put it in front of them. I have to let them reach it. And that's a huge challenge, because you always want to say what your vision is, how you want to solve the problem. This is the easy way, but this is the top-down way. And top-down in technology companies, and every company in the world is going to be a software and technology company. There isn't going to be a company which is not either a software company or a media company. Because technology basically is right now is entering every vertical of every business. And content, basically every business needs to create content. Even if you're a development studio, you need to be creating content, because selling ads is not enough. We have an ad blocker. Every one of us has an ad blocker, and we don't see the ads anymore. So in order for you to reach the users, your business clients and whatever, you need to start creating content. So this puts us in a very good position, because we're both media and technology. And that's why we were able basically to enter into different verticals. But like I said, it's in a technology environment, innovation cannot work top down. If I'm Chess or Vivacom, it's probably it's a different case. I say
probably not.
Yeah. But in a technology environment, the ideas have to reach you, and basically, only at a certain point you need to make an A-B decision. Only on the highest strategic level. So actually, at some point I started missing working on products. I started I missed the stage where we see it, we think, where do we put the like button? Do we scroll like this or do we scroll like that? But I had to get out of everything. And huge operational change. And apart from OKRs, now basically almost every person in the company has bonuses. So based on their the delivery of the OKRs, another operational change that we did is every quarter, because we embrace mistakes, we like mistakes, we like experiments, and every quarter in the beginning. I was the one like coming in stage and presenting, this is the results, this is the revenue, this is the whatever users. So now, and it's like for probably a year and a half, when we do a company meeting, it is the product managers, it is the service managers that come out on stage, and the number one thing that they start the presentation is, what did they fail in the last 3 months? This is the number one topic. In the beginning it was very difficult. Mm-hmm. It was very difficult. Like, no one from these people wants to get on stage and admit their failures. They were like, I think everywhere. So it was a very, very tough moment, and we had to do this like several times. Now it's completely different. Now it's not like only I don't care that you failed. I don't know why you failed. So now they come on stage and they say, "This was our goal. This is how we failed it. This is how much we failed it, and this is why exactly it happened." And they say, "We didn't took this into consideration. We didn't do that," because in almost all of the services you have repeating mistakes. You repeat one mistake after another. So, and now it's like, for me it's like super amazing. I always go on the back and just like sit. So this is the number one thing. The number two thing is they explain basically what they achieved. So it's like balanced. And it's super, super exciting. And everyone has a different way of managing their team, and different way of presenting, and different way of delegating, and different way of setting goals. Absolutely different ways. And I think that's super, super critical for a company which is like we're almost 200 people. Together with the partners, we're like probably 270 or something like that. It's very, very important in the company.
I want to start a question that has already, always been asked on startup events. The product, the idea, or the team? And what was the key for NetTeam for that exponential growth? As you were already talking about the team, my question is probably going to the product and to the marketing, because exponential growth without sales of a product is not a growth.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this question. It's not really a question. It's always the team. There isn't anything else. In the beginning, because of the way the company was managed, it had somehow been able to push out people who are proactive and they want to take charge and have the freedom to do what they want. So those people were either out or they were sitting on the sidelines. And the people who had emerged were the sort of processes, how do we do that? We want to build the product for 2 years. We want to have a very clear strategy, very clear road to market. We want to have at least 7-8 people team to do it. So this was the setup. We very quickly erased that and we said, we launched the product in maximum 3 months. I don't care how bad it is. And it even happened this year with the first site that I created. And basically, I created this site and I left it entirely to the team to redesign and to redo it. And we had like a huge 40% drop in the first 2 months after they did it. But because of the iteration after iteration effect, now it's like probably, I don't know, like 15 or whatever percent higher than before the redesign. So it's always the team. It's always the team. In terms of sales, the previous approach was let's have as many sites as we can, and this way we're going to sell more ads, and we're going to have more revenue. So the first thing that I did was actually shut down like 3 or 4 sites. So because the previous approach was, let's have more assets, even some of them are not working, but we cannot shut them down because we will look like idiots because we have failed the product, so we don't want to shut them down. Let's fuel even more resources into them. So the first thing we did was shut down like several sites. Up until now, probably we shut down 7 or 8 sites. So the first thing was shut down sites. The second thing was shut down formats. So we actually destroyed, like, I remember the discussion very clearly. We had an advertising format which was doing like 100,000 euro per year, 150 whatever, and but it was bad for the business because it was eating out of another format. But the advertisers were used, so they liked it. Sales were used because they had clients, and we said we're just shutting it down. So in the beginning, it was like pain after pain after pain. The biggest dilemma that we had, was video advertising is the fastest growing advertising. The video content is the majority of the content. Up until virtual reality, it will be the dominant content form. So we knew we had to go there. But our biggest video asset, which is VBOX 7, which is at some point it was the biggest site in Bulgaria, then for a very, very long time, it is number 2, was decreasing because YouTube was growing and Facebook introduced video in 2014, late 2014. So Facebook, like, at some point YouTube like flattened and Facebook like did like this. So we had one of the biggest sites was had a major problem. So in the previous version of the company, we were going to be putting a lot of resources. What we did was actually we said VBox is not important as a platform, and it was like a huge shock. I had pretty big fights with the TV guys because the TV guys they have and they are the majority shareholder. They have the mentality of I own the content, I own the channel, I own the advertising, so full control over everything, linear experience. And what we said is, unless we start distributing content across all of the video platforms, unless we start monetizing content over all of the video platforms, which is totally different than what we were doing, which is how Seven Talents was born, we're going to fail. And it's very difficult because the YouTube guys, they come in the office and they say, well, out of the revenue that you gain on YouTube, we're going to take 45%. And we're like, okay, I give already 35 to 50% to the agencies, 45 takes YouTube, so what's left? So TV immediately, they say, get out, you rat. And Paris is kicked out the door. but eventually we managed to do it, and now we have more inventory in video than probably the highest period of VBox ever, because our inventory is in VBox, which is probably getting the smallest now in YouTube and in Facebook, and VBox as a platform, I don't care what happens. Okay, I do care because there is a team managing it, but it totally changes to compared to what it used to be. It used to be a platform, a go-to place. You used to go there to watch fun stuff. Now it's like I almost don't care where the content is. I say almost because still VBox gets the highest amount, but then I have 55% in YouTube. In Facebook, I have zero right now, but we're working to get a contract there as well, and it will be the same as YouTube. So that's the type of change in terms of revenue and business model that we adopted immediately. So you can either fight the technology wave and sort of entrench yourself, or you can ride it. It's like and we preferred writing it. We preferred writing. So it's like a very, very big strategic shift. It was a very, very big strategic shift.
Well, when you started all these changes in the beginning, did you know that you want to build an exponential organization, or all these ideas came on the way?
Probably. I think the team is the one who built the organization.
Mm-hmm.
I think my main role was actually to back up a little bit and sort of stay out of the way. And it goes again to the question, which is so Netinfo's idea in the beginning, and my idea as well, because I have 30 years still there back then, was let's find the top talent for this position. This was my idea, and everyone, everywhere was like, find the best guy for the job. And
how
we were looking.
How
sorry?
Do you do it? How
no.
do you do it?
I stopped doing it.
How do you find them?
I don't want to find them.
How do you find it?
It was a very, very big change. So we were looking for the best guys for the job, but the job is in the digital economy, in the digital services. Digital as part of, let's say, digital services and businesses as part of GDP are like, it's like super insignificant. This is not the US market where already the top market cap companies are digital companies. they can work this way. We cannot work this way, and not only we, but like I think all of the European markets, we cannot work this way because we're in a digital here. Even e-commerce, it's like under 10% out of commerce. So it's like super tiny. You cannot find top talent in such a small niche. So what we, sorry?
So you create.
So number one approach is we started creating. We started growing organically within the company. And this is, so we weren't looking that much into, because you start from scratch, we weren't looking that much for the skills, but for the mindset. But we spent, we spent 1 year trying to, the developers especially, I want the top guys. You either can hire them, or they come with a different mindset. They've been working in VMware, okay, they're the top Java guys, but they've been working in an organization. They've been working in an organization where they're 1/10,000th of the organization. So I don't need that. I need people who take charge and action and responsibility and implement the change themselves. So number one, we started recruiting fresh talent and sort of training them. And this was the bottom up approach. Top down approach was we started hiring top talents. We weren't looking for top talents for the job because the job was still very small. It's like, for example, if it is in the media landscape, it's like the entire media landscape is much bigger than the digital media landscape. So I want a top talent. I want a top talent in media. I don't care if he's in TV or radio or whatever. So this is how the entire Seven Talents team was built. So no one was doing digital video. The guys that were doing digital video, they were doing it with the budgets for Hollywood productions or for TV productions. It wasn't working. So they were doing just like these pilots so that they can showcase digital video. No one was producing. I have a presentation next week regarding video, and I asked the guys for how much exactly are we producing, and I even don't remember the number, but it's like something like 600 clips per month, so no one was doing that scale. So I cannot find the top talent for digital video production, distribution, optimization, creative, and screen writing or whatever. So we had to focus on finding the top talent. So we started telcos. I want your best data scientists. That's how we build the team. Telerik, I want your best data analysts. Unicredit, I want your best IT guy. One of the product managers was a commercial officer at the SMS payment company. SMS aggregator. So we started just grabbing top talent. Top talent, because it's a very fast changing environment. You cannot take the right people for the right job, because the job changes all the time. I cannot set the what the job will be. They have to set it themselves. And the only way for this to happen in the long, okay, you can do it in a short term, like you can do it for like 1 year or 2 years or whatever, but if you want to have a sustainable and good business, you need to be able to do it over like longer period. And the only way is to have the top talents. And top talents, it's very funny, but it solves processes, because top talents, they hate process, they don't want process. It solves the dilemma between the manager and the employee, which is manager says you have to deliver 100 level, employee says, yeah, but the market, 70. So it solves it because the top talents, they are self-driven. They put themselves, they put the targets, the ambitious targets themselves, so I don't have to chase them. You forget immediately about working hours. It's like whatever. and the only thing, and you even forget about strategy. The only thing you need to remind yourself of every now and then is because they are very creative, so you need to have some sort of direction, which is not like we go there. It's like we go there. It's like this is where we want to go. This is the spectrum. So this is where video platforms end, and this is where content companies end, and this is where creative agencies go. So basically, you say it's like here somewhere. And I have very expensive mistakes after that. Because it was very obvious for me that we're doing probably not the best decision, we're not taking the best decision. And I even went to discuss it with the majority shareholder, that it's a huge risk. But what he told me is very, very important. He said, unless you make that mistake and unless you spend that money, the next person, the next time this person is not going to come to you and basically propose something brave and whatever. He's always going to be afraid that you're going to slap him on the head and say, you idiot. How can you even suggest such a thing?
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Sorry?
Awesome. To your management.
Yeah, it's like, I don't even know how, why I did it. But I wanted to go into price comparison because basically we're a data company. We're a data company, and that's why we can go into different verticals, because underlying is the data. The most important task is to be able to crunch and analyze and basically put machine learning under the data and sort of let it figure out for you which user to address, which user to acquire, and whatever. And it was and price comparisons give a lot of behavior data, so a lot of purchase data. So we didn't have a lot of purchase data, although we have like Gravo, which is doing like 50 million euro of turnover. But we in order to get the amount of data that we want, we need like probably, I don't know, 100 million euro of turnover. And we wanted to get price comparison, so it was very important for us. And right now, after a year of struggles, basically we're going to shut the project down.
But this was suggested by the team, you supported it.
Yeah.
The fact that you've got your exponential growth is because you supported the team all the way.
Absolutely,
through, right?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
It's very delicate now, because the team, they have this feeling that they because you have all around you, you have like on a quarterly gathering, 7 talents comes on stage and their presentation is only video. So they play the video and they have like all these stars of Crisco, whatever, starring in their series. They have events at Comic-Con that have like 3,000 people at the booth. They have like merchandising, they're selling waffles now, they're selling 2 million branded waffles, whatever. And they have like 160 million video views for the last quarter across all platforms. And they were managed to sign Aziz. and you come on stage and you're like, we lost only that amount of. So it's like still I don't know how to we don't know how to address this, but we're trying to sort of again motivate those guys to come up with something else and to switch a little bit the direction. And it's happening, but it carries a little bit of bitter taste.
Well, you're 45 million up, you haven't done something.
But basically, based on this approach,
Actually
the team is coming and proposing even building the business itself.
Mm-hmm.
And what about acquiring businesses? What you're doing as well?
In the beginning, there was
because
like...
it's part of the growth.
Yeah, absolutely. In the beginning, it was very clear for me, it was obvious for me that we cannot achieve huge growth only organically. And basically there are no companies. Okay, there are some companies that do it, but almost all the matured market companies, they're like growing also externally through acquisitions. So, and we did it for another reason as well, because we needed to have access at the time, like beginning 2013, we needed to have access to smaller teams. NetImp was all, the three companies had already formed a big team, so big teams move slowly, so we needed to have smaller teams around us who, by interacting and engaging with them, sort of showcase to our guys how you can launch a product when it's not ready. And you know, it's like Reid Hoffman says, if you're not embarrassed by your first product launch, you launch too late. It's like, and our guys were like, they want, it's like, two. The last Vesti redesign was for 2 years. It was under production for 2 years. The last Direct News redesign was in 3 months. So, I mean, so in the beginning, they were super afraid of acquisitions.
Okay.
Yeah. Because, okay, how to put it gently. It's like, let's just say that the previous, let's say, in the history of the company, acquisitions were made only to pump the valuation for the future exit. And it was very clear throughout the process. So NetInfo was buying companies just to pump itself up. And I'm going to be honest that I have been buying companies previously also to pump up the, back then it was Reach of Tiemens, whatever. It's just like stupid. But yes, I had consultants come to me and say, buy LexBG or AlbumBG, you're going to get from fifth place to fourth place. yeah, it's busy. It was 2010 or 2011. Mm-hmm. So now it's the approach is totally different. So in the beginning they didn't want to buy, first because they were being bought for valuation purposes only, and second because they had several fails. So when I went in 2014, I told the team that I want to buy the Grabo guys. And Grabo had just walked away from a deal with NetInfo in like a year and a half ago, under a signed deal from NetInfo side, with approval from Sonoma. So they had walked out of the, and NetInfo had started delivering the advertising, and Grabo had walked out of the deal. And when I told the team, we want to buy Grabo, and they were like, oh, this guy is a total idiot. They said, he's going to trick you, it's like a fake, whatever. And so they were very, very aggressive towards external, everything, external teams, outsourcing of products, everything is external, consultants. So when we closed the deal, together with several internal projects, I created a slide about a presentation on meets in NetInfo, meets and legends in NetInfo, and we said, okay, we couldn't do that. We did it. No one wanted to buy video advertising from VBox because it was mainly pirated site. So this was one of the things. We don't sell video ads in NetInfo. And we started selling it. So the acquisitions in the beginning, I was the one who kicked them off. Right now, let me think. But
now, yeah. When you acquire them, and you're saying it's very important for the team just to be working with smaller teams, does that mean that
yeah.
all the business you acquire,
yes.
and you put your team to in collaboration with the team, so you're operational in the businesses you already acquired?
Very, very, very good question. I don't go operationally in the business.
So how is the team, what does the team care then?
Which team? Our team.
Yes.
They care.
It's not connected work-wise with them.
They care because they learn. It's like free knowledge for them.
How will they learn if they don't work together?
No, they work together, but we don't have operational management over them.
Ah.
So let's say we solve. I'll give you a super. It's in the e-commerce field, so it's exactly your field. So eBay, one of our partners, they have two. Is everyone alive there? They have two very, very big problems, which every e-commerce site has. One is, we have, let's say, 2,000 buyers. How do we find more buyers? So we want more users. We want to get from 2,000 to 20,000. And number two is, how do we increase the purchase rate? So right now they buy 2 point whatever times per month. How do we get it to 3? Two super simple tasks. So what we do is, because we have more resources, so we have data scientists, we have machine learning engineers, we have optimization guys, we have SEO experts, we have Analytics 360, which if you want to buy it, for example, from Google, it's like $200,000 per year, for example, something like that. So we have brutal tools and talents. It's not only tools. It's like we have a brutal ad tech setup. It's not brutal because it can go much higher, but compared to 1 year or even 2 years ago, it's like... So we take their task and we clarify it. So our guys, they make out the reports. We have our own data management platform, so they find the user IDs, they find the behavior of those users, and they put down a very good data set. A very good data set. So this is the input and this is the output. So this is what you put and this is what you get. So what we do is two things. Number one, we try to solve the problems ourselves. And number two, we invite basically AI teams who are focused in machine learning to solve the problems with machine learning. And we do it in very quick iterations. So we give the entire base, they work on the base, and they suggest which hashed IDs, obviously, we can chase and find either as users, so what if we can suggest at what purchase point to existing users for them to buy more. And we test it for the next 2 weeks. So they come up with a solution, we implement it in real environment, we test it. And we don't go with one external team, we go with two or three external teams. So, and within this process, which is a very simple process, our guys get to know the business of eBay, external teams get to know the business of eBay. Some of them suggest meaningful solutions, which we connect together with eBay.
And then they implement.
And they implement. They want to. They may want to implement. They may not want to.
But it's their decision.
It's absolutely their decision. We never go operational in the business, and we never buy 100%. We always keep a significant. Basically, we use our approach the way we are. We always leave a significant percentage in the company, in the founders, managers, whatever,
so
that they're motivated. Even if they come and they say, okay, you buy 80%, I'll stay with 20, we say, I don't want 80%, because 20 will not be enough for you.
So what's the maximum you take?
Maximum is 51.
Really?
Yeah.
Good idea.
Because we want to consolidate, but
that's solid.
But nothing else. And we have acquisitions that are not right now are like, I don't know, probably 2.5 years.
Yeah.
Okay.
What other business decisions did you take on the way to exponential growth?
I like the quiz. But let's first see if there are like more questions. because I think that someone wanted to ask them, you know?
I was just a quick one. You said you shut down the business. Can you just rebrand it and resell it? So you don't want to have a reputation risk, I believe. I mean, if you work so much on the site,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
than people are used to it. Isn't it much easier to just select a small team, or maybe you want to rebrand it because you don't want to have
some of the businesses we're selling, yes. Some of the businesses we're selling. Some of the products we're selling. Even as we speak, we're speaking about three or four acquisitions and one or two products that are going to be either sold or shut down. So if it is big enough, if it is interesting enough, we sell. If it's not, we shut down. And sometimes we don't, so we don't sell. So for example, the two sports sites, because they were, you know, both of them were big. So if we sell an asset which is in competition with our assets, or the one that remains, or something similar, or whatever, we shut down. We cannot sell something which is strategically risky for us. Not important, but risky. So if, because there are some of them are assets which have a very high page rank, but they're good, well optimized in SEO, so it's better for us to shut them down and to then to sell it. Because imagine if someone buys it and creates and manages it very well, because it's very often the case. For us, it's like one portfolio of many services. For someone who buys it and focuses solely on it, it's the one product, and he'll probably be able to manage it much better than us. So that's why sometimes we just kill.
What tools do you use for exponential growth?
It's a good question. So no task in the company can be implemented. I mean, like product task. Even sales tasks now are running our operational management without putting it into Redmine. So Redmine is our task management. It's like our workhouse. In the beginning, we were managing only our dev resources. So basically, the pipeline of the products was there. But now, everything which requires even the smallest touching of, let's say, an SEO guy or a marketing guy, goes as a task in Redmine. So this is it's like a foundation.
Mm-hmm.
And then every team basically uses either Asana or Slack, or it's like basically they decide themselves. It's like all of the team goals are in Redmine and Google Drive. So basically in Drive we have every day we upload basically an XML file for the different teams, for the different goals that they're chasing, and they're publicly available to the company. So every time everyone can access them and check them. So it's like complete transparency and openness. And obviously we have a huge uptake setup, but it's like very very specific, and it's a little geeky. I don't want to go there.
Yeah.
It's like a data management platform with BigQuery databases. Mm-hmm. So for example, in the Office 360 suite, I'm going to sound like a Google sales guy, but in the Office 360 suite of analytics, what you see is a sample of the data. So everything you see in your Google Analytics accounts is a sample of the data. The real data is sitting in a BigQuery database behind it. And once you get, once you pay, obviously, you get to access that data. And if you have skilled guys, they can run scripts on that data. So it's like brutally powerful. It's like amazingly powerful. And it's like it's always digging deeper. It's like it's always digging deeper and giving the access to your guys to dig deeper.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes with a lot of cost. But every year, in the last 4 years, we have reinvested the growth. So every single year, we're reinvesting the growth. So in the beginning, they were like milking it, and every year we are like, sometimes it's crazy. I hear the financial guys calling me, screaming sometimes, and me screaming back and fighting. But probably that's the job manager should do is like fight for the highest amount of expenses that he can get and then get out of the way.
what other important things we need to know about exponential growth and how to achieve exponential growth, and afterwards we can start taking practical examples.
Yeah, okay. I think the biggest thing is to position yourself in a market which is growing. I love big markets. I don't like small markets. And surround yourself with top talented people and get out of their way. Basically, you cannot achieve exponential growth if you align every step of the way. You cannot be putting strategies and like planning for 5 months, 6 months, and doing like heavy meetings and having one guy approving the work of the other guy and approving the work of the other guy, and not only after that starting the project. And for example, in 18, we're going to do probably the biggest change ever, which will sort of get to the end of the delegation process from managers to top talents working as employees, and it's going to be super fun. But we're going to give the ability to the developers who are working on the platforms to be executing scripts on the products without the approval or even the knowledge of the team and the product managers. So every developer will be able to execute the script on, let's say, AWS or whatever, and for this he is not going to need my approval, the approval of the product officer, the team manager, the team lead, or whatever.
Why do you do that?
Because we need to be quicker. We need to, it's like, you cannot have one guy on top telling to another guy on top, telling to another guy on top, telling to another guy, telling to a developer what to do. It cannot happen. It can never work this way. It's too slow.
Was this your idea? How was the idea of the team?
It's a mixed. A lot of the solutions we find, we cannot actually trace where the idea came from. It's very strange. We cannot find it. It's like the primordial soup. It's like someone says something in the meeting room, then you take it from there, then someone continues the sentence, then someone behind you screams something, you interrupt the meeting, then you continue it again. So it was born like 1 or 2 months ago during, I don't want to call it brainstorming, because I don't think we have brainstorming sessions at all. It's like, I don't think it works that well. But and the way it's done, it's very simple. It's like, we have A/B and whatever, multiple testing environment. So they implement the script, they deploy it on the, let's say, version X. They run it on 10,000, 50,000, 100,000 users, whatever. Because we have the measurement and reporting platform, which is like in real time. They benchmark it toward the main version, and if it returns better results, then they inform their manager and they say, "I did that."
And who does the user test?
The user test. They have a deploy environment immediately. So you implement the code, and immediately, like I don't know, 500, and then till the end of the day, 10,000 users, which is a small sample of the site, they see the new version.
So,
no, we test it with our own users, but we don't test it with board meetings and financials.
Oh, yes,
we immediately deploy it. It's like, yeah, it's like. So that's the way we do it.
Okay.
Let's take some practical example. Who from you wants to share his business and to ask for advice, Christo?
Not sell, share, because no, maybe they heard sell, I don't know.
Nobody
wants to sell?
So,
how much do you want?
I'm trying to devise a product which uses companies, the data from Bulgarian companies, which they send to NAP, all these data which they have sent each month. So I want my product to get this data and to turn it into analysis on their sales, purchases, things like that. Like, I've already developed that, and now I'm a few steps from the selling stage. And so my idea is I want to sell this freely. I want the entire product to be free. So the Bulgarian companies, because the business intelligence sphere in here is a really small amount of the companies use it. And I want just to show the companies that just by analyzing their data, they can get a lot of insights. So what my question is, for me to achieve exponential growth just from the start, do I have to have some kind of price on my product, or is better to the product to be free, and then when they see the value from the product, they want to add some extensions or attachments to it, and this is going to be
very good question. Thank you. It's something in order to scale in the beginning, you need to do things which are totally opposite. You must be doing only non-scalable things. In order to scale, all your actions must be non-scalable. In the beginning. Because this is the stage where you get to know the most of your clients, yourself, and this is the stage where you can add the most value to the users. So, just imagine the following. You have your product right now, and tomorrow you can change the entire way it looks, because you don't have any clients, or you have like 5 or 10 clients. Imagine tomorrow Facebook just shooting down your wall, or just instead of a horizontal wall doing a horizontal wall. They can never do it. Okay, not never, but they cannot do it. If they want to get from here to there, they're going to have to pass through 50 other stages over a 20-year period, because they're already scaled. So the amount of product change that they can do is like very, very small. Every small implementation that they do is like they get millions of people hating them and stuff like that. So they have the scale, but they don't have the... they cannot increase the value in a scaled manner to the users. You can increase the value in scale. So the value that you deliver to your clients can be increased with, let's say, 500% over 2 months. Because you speak to 2 or 3 of them, you spend a lot of time, you travel to Bucharest if you have to. You speak to the clients, you find out their pains, and you change, for example, totally the look of the product. And in the beginning, in order to scale, in the beginning you must do exactly the opposite. You must do totally non-scalable things. You cannot start with the approach that you're speaking to 10,000 users, business users. In the beginning, you need to do totally unscalable things. So, for example, the Airbnb guys, when they launched, they were running like a year and a half after launch. And their initial idea was put an air bed next to your bed and invite someone who is at a conference to sleep at your room and give him a breakfast and for him to pay like a super small amount. So this, and they were having, after a year and a half, they were having like 15 or 20 bookings. A year and a half in the process, they were funded and they were having like this. So what they did was they went to live with the people renting their apartments. They went to live there. They faked the story that they're going to photograph their apartments in a good manner with professional photographs. So they presented themselves as the photographs of the company. And in order to photograph, they wanted to stay there and stuff like that. So in the process, they started speaking to these guys. And which is a super non-scalable process. You know, you cannot, like, you know, Mark Zuckerberg is not going to come to your office and say, okay, let me see how you swipe. But in the beginning they did it. And what they found out was that their product should be a little bit different. People want a little privacy. They want a separate room. They want a separate apartment, an entire apartment. And once they implemented the changes, it was like 10x, 10x growth. They stayed in other people's apartments for like 2 or 3 months or something like that, which is super non-scalable. Everyone would advise you, go work on your product, stuff like that, but the time that you spent with selling your product and understanding the needs of the business users, it's not scalable, but it's going to add the most of the value to the product. So,
somebody else? Thank you. So, in relation to this question, what is the exact time of preparing the prototype?
Oh, very good question.
Yes.
Is it exact in hours or minutes?
In your case, in his case,
yeah.
I have another case, but you'll show
yeah.
it a bit later.
It's for every business, it's different. But it's like I said, if you're not embarrassed by your first product launch, you've launched too late. So right now, given the stage that technology is in, given the fact that you can launch one of the last deals that we did, the guy was able to reach 1.5 million level of turnover per year with a product that wasn't his. He was licensing a Shopify type of product. He was paying 50 level per month. So, yes, he could have started building 1 year, 3 developers, 2 designers, whatever, product, then launching, then putting money. He didn't do it. He paid the, I don't know, 20 euro or 25 euro fee for the platform, and he launched. So the answer is you need to launch immediately. It's not even 2 weeks. It's like you need to launch immediately. You have the idea, give it to someone to create a landing page immediately, and send people to that landing page. I mean, send people to that landing page. And the way I would do it is, for example, go to fever.com. It's like freelancer.com, but for designers. So tell them, I want a logo and I want a design of the landing page. It's going to cost no more than $50 or $100, whatever. And tell them, give me those two things. They'll give it to you. You'll have several reviews. Use whatever, I don't care, whatever hosting provider or WordPress template or Wix.com, it doesn't really matter at all. And immediately launch 10 versions. 10 versions. So one version is understand your business data, or understand if you sell well, improve your sales by more data or whatever. Like, put 10 different versions. And figure out, put people on the site of different landing pages. You're not going to have a product, but it's going to say, if you're interested in this product, sign up right now. So it's going to be launched in like, I don't know, 1 month, 2 months, whatever. No one is going to be, you don't have a company doing 100 million euro, so no one is going to sue you if you don't launch. So just launch. You need to launch immediately.
So basically you mean don't do an A-B testing, but do an A-B-C-D-E-F-G-H-I
of the of the concept. Don't do A-B testing of the product. Do an A-B testing of the concept. The moment you have the idea, if you haven't launched in, let's put it more gently, if you haven't launched a landing page in the next 1 month, let's say, it's not going to work. Sorry.
Next question.
I got back from the UK. It was like 1st of October. Even 2005, which was like super, super. We launched the new site in end of November, something like that, or 1 month and a half, because it was slow. It was super slow. We were choosing from different companies. It was very, very slow.
Well, now is the time to take advantage that
Christo
is here and he has an experience in that. So if you would like to know how to use the techniques for exponential growth, now.
We're talking about a product. What about an event, like a launch? Because you start talking about landing page. Just for example, I told you.
Same. Do every event starts with driving users to the event, like either subscribing, want to learn more, buy tickets. I saw that Plummet from Webit launched the early bird, 1,000 early birds tickets. Now, he launched it now. He launched it this week. And the event is like April. So for that, okay, it's a well-known brand and everybody knows it, but he only needed one landing page and one email. That's it. So launch, do the landing page of the event, immediately launch. Start email, social search, articles, immediately. Subscribe, sign up, early bird, 500 level, 50 level, whatever it is. Launch. We're huge fans right now. Right now we started, it's like the definition for entrepreneurship, it's to jump off the cliff with the parts for the airplane and to assemble it while you're falling. That's it. It's like you cannot wait for the perfect time when the wind will blow, when you have your plane ready. Jump, assemble it during the fall, and in 1% of the cases. But that's the good thing, that you can start many and fail many times. It's like trying is super, super important. So it's like immediately.
One more question for me. Do you think that exponential growth is possible in social enterprises?
Of course.
Especially this connected to education.
I don't see any. Yesterday during the pitch, there was a guy who is a social enterprise. He's using 3D printing to create small figures which are designed by criminals.
Okay.
Yeah, they're designed by criminals, like juvenile delinquents. They design the figures.
In jail?
It's juvenile delinquent. It's not. They're not in jail. They're in like probitelen dom. So they design them and craft them. Sorry? They design them, he puts them in 3D printing, and then he sells them in all types of events. And he started from Bulgaria, and right now he's participating in forums in London. He has bookings from the US, so he's starting to do it everywhere. So it's like I don't see any restriction whatsoever. Now technology is very cheap. It's getting super cheap. So it's like all of the industries are going to get somehow disrupted by technology. So it's like
what about
e-commerce or some other advices on how to become an explorer? commerce is tricky. Commerce is tricky. It's as we speak, we're trying to break down the DNA of e-commerce. I think one of the main limitations is the market there. So I think e-commerce is always driven by commerce. So you need to have the commerce market, and even in the US, you have e-commerce is like not more than 30%. So you need to have the big commerce market and then the big e-commerce market if you want to grab a bigger share. So if you want to grow, and we have examples from Bulgaria which have achieved tremendous growth in e-commerce, which have grown in 10 plus markets. Okay, some have grown like from zero to hero and then back to zero. some are still growing. Some are still growing. Okay. Some of them are already bankrupt, so I don't want to.
Okay.
But for example, MIMO, they have continuously grown.
How is trend though, did you?
It's like flatline. But MIMO are now like doing something like that. 40-50 million turnover in 3 markets or 4 already. So it's like you have e-commerce cases coming out of Bulgaria which are growing brutally. You have Remix.
Yeah.
You have Remix, which is like second hand clothes.
Yeah.
Which are like 10 plus markets, which is like 100 million internal.
So
you have a good idea for next guest. But I don't want to speak about them. But actually, I would invite someone who went from zero to hero to zero, because I think that those type of stories are the most interesting ones, and there are examples. It's really amazing to see you grow from 1 million to, let's say, 30-40 million in revenue and then go back to 1 million. It's like a roller coaster ride, and it's truly inspiring.
I have
talked to
you for next guest for sure. Do you have any other questions?
I have a question. So I want a little bit more to focus on the team, because for me, I share your opinion, the team is the most important for one company. So what do you do to satisfy your team? Like if you have only 8 teams, that's very cool, but they're people and you have to make them happy. How do you make them happy?
You make themselves happy.
So you don't motivate them, you don't make survey with them, like happy.
I heard the survey word. Okay. In the beginning we had especially when we joined MTG, it's like whatever it was called, personal development appraisal, like PDA forms, STI agreements. Even still now we have one survey running in the company coming from MTG, because it's global, it's for all MTG companies. Let me put it this way. The company is not your family. So, obviously, you cannot run a survey in the family. You cannot run a survey with your mom and dad. Mom and dad, can you please qualify me? How much do you think I did last year? Do you think I'm smart? Do you think I communicate well? You cannot ask that. So, but the company is not the family. What the company what the company is, it's like a football field. It's like a football team. It's like a soccer team. It's not your family, but it is the people that you spend the most of your time with. It is the people that you share a common goal with. You know, your goals. You want to win the Champions League. You have a common goal. If there is someone in the team which is not performing well, the team, in the best case, puts him out. No, the team puts him out. Or he gets uncomfortable because he sees that he's not being able to run in the same pace. So he basically gets off board himself. In your family, you cannot fire your mom, you know, or your sister. You cannot say, you're here, your personal development, your test is here, so get on board. But in the team you do. In the team you do. If you're an average player, the team boosts you, so they take you out. So, and in the team, as well as in your company, you cannot run a survey. You're driven by you're commonly driven by the goal that you share and by the values that you have. And how do you rank values? You cannot really rank values. I mean, are your values more valuable than my values? It's like something which vibrates in the air, and everyone feels it, but they know that they can go their own way. They know what everyone else is doing, but they know that they have the ability to go the other way, and that they're not going to be punished. Very important. So, tests and surveys. And it's the same with users, by the way. You cannot do a survey with the users. You cannot ask them, why do you like our site? What if we introduce what else will you shop more? It doesn't happen this way. The user, most of the time, doesn't know what exactly he wants. You know, he doesn't exactly know what he wants. He knows that he wants the best product, the best experience. But what is best? It's like for every user it's different, and very often they compare it to something else. They say, I want this, like whatever. So it's like asking the users and asking your team. It's like you are going to get insight. So this is a job for the HR department, if they can do it well, but obviously we do it as well. But it is, I would never base my team strategy on something like that. It is something, whatever it is. It's like perks. It's like free coffee, free drinks, breakfasts, free home Wi-Fi, free TV home and stuff like that, all free working hours and whatever. It's like one of those things, but those things cannot make a good team. It's like one of those things.
Do you think do it?
Yeah, we're going Friday.
Where?
Basco. We're going team drinking.
Yeah.
This year that we have zero agenda. There is no agenda.
How do you get feedback?
Data, only data.
So data. Yeah.
We have voluntary data as well. We take the decisions from 95% of the decisions we take on behavior data. So what they do on the sites. The other 5% we take from we do external social studies. So we hire like TNS, whatever, to do a study on some topic, and we do on-site surveys. But it's like for brand perception and stuff like that, which are like, we're never going to change the product based on that. We might change different things, but it's not going to be the product. We do it mainly on data, behavior data. How often do they come? It's like a million things.
And I guess you're using tools for analyzing.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like, Office 360, which is Google Analytics, the expensive version. We have a data management platform where every single user has a unique ID, cookie, email address, social login, which sites did he visit, what are his interests, demography data, where does he live, what's his age, every everything.
One final question from our partner Roberto.
Where is he? He's gone.
How do you see the world in 5-10 years, and how do you prepare the company for the big change?
We look at the world for the next 3 to 6 months.
Okay.
Of course, when the financial guys come, we show them a budget bridge. We sign it with closed eyes. But we plan for like 3 to 6 months, and our main investment right now is basically in data and in machine learning. So I explained to you how we're going to have developers writing code and deploying it immediately. Our next step of that would be machine writing code and then deploying it immediately. So this is where the world is right now. Probably the biggest products in the world right now, it's machines writing their own code. So it's like people are not creating products anymore. It's machines that are creating products, and we want to get there as well. So it's like I was in San Francisco in May, and there was the SVP of Amazon, who said that 95% of their code is written by machines. And he said in the beginning, we were writing only, we thought that machine learning will replace only price, it's like fundamental things, but now, actually, the machine is creating, for example, Netflix, the image that you see for the series, it is very often moderated somehow by a machine based on your viewing habits. So they totally alter, because if, for example, if you like violent movies, probably you will see a more violent color. So they're creating content, they're creating images, they're creating text. The description will be different. So it's like, all of the time, this is running in real time, and it's being done by machines. So it's like 95% is, and I, the most beautiful thing is that everything that we have seen so far has been done by humans on machines that understand text. So machines, they couldn't understand images. Everything is like, if I want to visit a certain site, the developer writes code, which is text, and it is displayed on the site. Everything, every product that we use is based on text right now. The moment machines, which now we are living in those days, the moment machines understand images, it's like the moment that the entire internet economy and digital business is beginning from the beginning of the age. So the entire internet digital revolution so far has been based on text. Now, with computer vision, machines are able to understand images, which is a huge, root of shit.
Yeah, and we go into another very big topic. You would love to talk about AI.
Ah, okay.